looking forward to the remainder of our songs and our time together. So thankful that you are here. Still some that are finding their way to their seats, and that is great. Let me remind you or make you aware of a couple of things as you're finding your seats this morning. I'm not going to take the time to get you to pull out your bulletin. I hope you did get a bulletin. If you didn't, please make sure you get one before you leave. We want you to know what all's going on and be informed. Obviously, if you have any questions about any of those things, then let me know at any time. Certainly be glad to give you any details. Yes, Mr. John?
We just have one left.
You got one bulletin left. Okay. Well, we can make some more. That's okay. Thank you for letting us know that. And, and before I forget, Ms. Tony said to let you guys know that she has a card if you would like to sign it for Wanda. Her brother passed away, and most of you know Eric and Wanda. Some of our new people or guests may not know that, but her brother passed away, and so she's got a card for you to sign. I'm going to send that to her. I appreciate her taking the effort and the time to do that. So make sure you see Miss Tony before you leave today. Let me remind you of a couple things coming up. First of all, the young men's class will meet again this coming Wednesday night. It'll be their second meeting. This will be the second month, and we're excited about that and looking forward to that. I know Dr. Doug Vance is going to do a wonderful job with those young men, and would love for you to make sure and get your teenage, your young adult men here for Wednesday night at 6:30. And they would benefit greatly, I promise you, and you don't want to miss out on that. Also, tonight, and not next Sunday, thank you, Marcus, for that reminder, but the following Sunday, we will have a special presentation in our evening service that starts at 6 p.m., and going to be presenting a video series, a two-part series from Frank Turek. And he is the author of I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, and it's an apologetic approach. It's very good. It'd be so insightful, beneficial to you. It doesn't matter what your age, whether you're a young person, a teenager, or an adult, you will find this very much worth your effort and your time. And again, we will start at 6 p.m. Each of the video presentations are around 40 minutes, and so again, that will be in our evening service tonight, not next Sunday, because next Sunday is Mother's Day. We won't have an evening service, but then the following Sunday, we will do the second part to that and would invite any and all of you to come, and you'll be blessed by that, I assure you. And then let me just remind you about our upcoming picnic. Again, I don't usually do a whole lot of announcements, but this is a biggie. We have our annual picnic coming up on the 21st, and the Cooks are going to host it again for our second annual At the Cooks picnic. It's not our second annual picnic, but At the Cooks picnic. So we're excited about that and looking forward to it. Hope that you will plan to be a part of that. But let me just, I say that to say that there is a sign-up sheet in the foyer. And if you are planning to come, here's what I need you to do. I need you to go to that sign-up sheet and put a name and out to the side a number, and you have time between now and the 21st to sign up for what you're going to bring as far as the sides. But it is imperative that I know how many to plan for, because I got to know how many to buy hot dogs and hamburgers for, okay? So please give me an indication of how many you plan to bring. If it's just going to be one person, then that's fine. If it's going to be 20 people, I really need to know that, okay? And we want you to bring 20 people, okay? But we need to know how many to plan for. And so not only for the food, but the chairs as well, and that sort of thing. So anyway, if you will go to the sign-up sheet sometime, preferably before the 21st, and let me know how to plan. I would really appreciate that, okay? Several other things going on. I hope that you'll get that bulletin and be informed and involved in every one of these special activities and events. So thankful that you are here today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. If you're willing and able to stand, please do so, and we will pray, and then we will get back into our worship time this morning. Let's pray. Father, it's a beautiful day outside. We thank you so much for the privilege and opportunity that we have to be here at your house again this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the comfortable place that we can come and to worship safely and to study your word. We look forward to our time together. We're so thankful for these that have chosen to be a part of our service today. Have a few guests with us as well this morning. We're so thankful for that. Always glad to have guests with us. We pray that you'd help our people to as I know they already have, to welcome our guests and encourage them to continue to come back here, and Lord, just pray that you pour out your Spirit upon not only our guests, but everyone in this service, especially, Lord, as we transition into the remainder of our worship time and prepare to study your Word. Lord, remind us of what we are here for, why we are here, what this is all about. This is not just a social gathering. We're not here just to have a good time and not here just to hang out and to be with friends, although we get to enjoy the fellowship and we enjoy the warm embrace and the welcome and the family atmosphere that we have in this church. We appreciate that. But Lord, we need to be reminded that it's not about us, that it's about you. We're here to worship you. We're here to focus on you. We're here to elevate you. And Lord, if we're here this morning concentrating on the things of our past week or the things of the coming week, if we're disturbed and concerned about other events that are going on outside of this moment, then we're going to miss you and we're going to miss what you want us to get. So I pray, Lord, that you would just get our attention just now, that you would calm our hearts and our minds. No doubt there's probably someone even in the service here this morning that's anxious and fearful. Some that are troubled by some news that they have received, and maybe some even under conviction about issues and sin and decisions in their life. But Lord, I pray that you would just sweep across our hearts and our minds and in this service your peace, that peace that passes all understanding, and God, that you would just draw our attention to you. And I pray, Lord, that as you do that and as the songs are sung and the message of those songs penetrate not just our ears, but our hearts, Lord, that it would just get us so tuned in with you and the Spirit and what you want us to see and to hear and to learn today, God, that we would just be so overwhelmed with your presence and the work of God in our hearts and our lives. Now, I pray, God, that you'd do something mighty in this service and in our time here today. We are here to honor and exalt you, and we pray that you would find it all pleasing. And Lord, that you would bless each one that's here. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done already, for what you're going to do with the remainder of this time. We trust you with it. We give it to you, and we pray your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Amen.
We're going to sing this morning about our reliance on God, our trust in him. That's where we're going to start. Number 451. Trust and obey. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 5.
Trust.
as number 446, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. 446, we'll sing all three verses.
Stand as we go to number 472.
In My Life, Lord, Be Glorified, number 472. We'll sing all three verses and then repeat the first. Thank you.
Timothy chapter 4, as we are looking again at verse 7 through 10. This is the second part of this, what should be a two-part message, and I've titled the message, Let's Get Fit. And as I said last week, we're going to the gym, and we're not talking about the physical gym where we go and do cardiovascular exercises and work our muscles and all those things, although we may need to do some of those. We won't ask you to stand up and stretch and get on the exercise clothes and all of those things, but we, in a figurative sense, want to go to the gym, at least spiritually speaking today, and you'll see that connection as we read our text and make the application. We will do a really quick review of what we've already covered, point number one and its subpoints, and then jump into point number two immediately following. But before we do that, let's look at our text and read together. Again, if you do not have a Bible, we certainly encourage you to read along with. It'll be on the wall behind me on both sides, and I will be reading from the CSB, but you're certainly welcome to read along with any other translation that you have. Again, the title today is Let's Get Fit, 1 Timothy 4, verse 7 through 10. Please read with me. Paul writing to Timothy says, "But have nothing to do with pointless and silly myths. Rather, train yourself in godliness. For the training of the body has limited benefit, but godliness is beneficial in every way, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. This saying is trustworthy and deserves full acceptance. For this reason, we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe." Well, again, quick review. Point number one was the don'ts of getting fit. The don'ts. First of all, letter A was don't have anything to do with myths and useless fables. Letter B was don't use your time with worldly instructions. Letter C was don't overemphasize the physical. Obviously, we had several things to say about each of those. We won't rehash all of those. And if you missed it last week, there is good or bad news, whichever way you look at it. You can go online and review and replay that service through YouTube or Facebook if you desire to make the connection with the rest of those points. Point number two, this morning is the do's. I warned you last week that we would pick up with the do's this morning. We looked at the negative side of what we don't want to do if we want to get fit. Today we want to look at the positive side of the instructions that Paul has for Timothy and for us as believers on what we do need to do. However, there will be a few little negatives that I'll share in here as we get rolling today, but I am really excited about some of the things I want to share with you this morning in this message. Letter A, first of all, under point number two, the do's is do focus on godliness. Do focus on godliness. We've looked at what we are not to focus on, what we are not to get distracted with. What we do need to do is we need to realize what we do need to focus on if we want to get fit in a spiritual sense, as Paul is instructing in our text. You see what he says in verse 8, "For the training of the body has limited benefit, but godliness is beneficial in every way." And then look at what he said in the close of verse 7. He says, "Rather train yourself in godliness." You know, if you looked around in a lot of Christians' lives, and maybe even in a lot of churches today, you would swear that people are training in godlessness instead of godliness. But Paul was very specific in his sense, in his teaching, and his training, in that he is trying to tell Timothy and all those who would follow under him, and for us today, that we need to be, keyword, I love this word, we say it so often because I think it is a very biblical idea, and that is intentional in our focus, and that is we need to be intentional about godliness.
Amen.
Can I put it another way? You and I, no matter how good you may think you are, and no matter how close to God you may think you are, and no matter how long you've been going to church, and no matter what you've done in church, you will not just stumble upon godliness.
Yeah.
It ain't just going to fall in your lap. You don't just raise your hand and God fills you up with it. It doesn't happen that way. There's some intentionality that Paul is instructing for us as believers. Now, obviously, we got to ask the question, well, why do I want godliness? Why do I want to be intentional about godliness? Why in the world do I want to train? Why, that sounds like sweat. That sounds like effort. That sounds like intentionality. There we go again. It sounds like being purposeful. That sounds like putting forth some effort. I'd rather just kick back on the proverbial couch or recliner and watch the TV for a while and not put so much effort into my religion. Well, again, we're not talking about religion, are we? We're talking about a relationship with God. But in order for that relationship to get where it needs to be and where God wants it to be with you, you've got to be intentional.
Amen.
You're not going to just suddenly grow as a Christian if you continue the same pattern that you've always had. You know the old phrase is, if you keep doing the same old stupid things, the same old stupid ways, you'll continue to get the same old stupid results. And that's not only true in our physical lives and in our businesses and in our relationships with one another, but that is so very true in our relationship with God as well. And so Paul is clearly instructing us in this text that we need to focus on godliness.
Amen.
Now, we live in a time when focus is a challenging issue and it's difficult in our world today. We are told by the professionals that people just don't have much of an attention span anymore. That you can't expect to hold people's attention for more than 20 minutes. And I don't accept that very much. And I know that they will argue, well, you're just being difficult and stupid for not accepting that. Well, you know, the reason I don't accept it is because I see what other things do capture our attention for lots longer than 20 minutes without any trouble. The things that we're interested in, we have no trouble committing more than 20 minutes to and don't want nobody interrupting what we're committed to. Amen? For example, if it's a baseball game or a football game, now, Daniel, you love the Dodgers. If the Dodgers on, you don't want me calling you about halfway through, especially if it's a tight game, and having a conversation about the tomatoes. If the Dodgers are on, you want to concentrate on the Dodgers game. Now, bless God, that game may take 3 hours to finish, but you want to commit every bit of that time wholly to that game. Amen? And I'd be the same about the Braves, and the Brewers would be the same about Kansas City Chiefs, did I get that right? And whoever else it might be, okay? And it'd be the same about if our grandkids were out there on the football field or the baseball field as well, right? We're committed, and hey, don't distract me. I want to give that time and attention to that. I am focused on it. And if your work calls you, you look at the phone, nope, not taking that one right now. And your neighbor calls you, well, they may be dying, but I'll get back in touch with them later, right? You see, we really don't have as much of a focus problem as we think we do, or as the professionals tell us that we do, as much as it is priorities. What Paul is saying is that as a believer, what we've got to do is focus on godliness, or we've got to make God a priority. We've got to make godliness a priority. In other words, you are not going to become more godly, and you're not going to get closer to God on accident. And you're not going to get there if you don't make it a priority. You don't just stumble into it. Hey, look, I found godliness all of a sudden. I am so close to God, I'm so thankful I just got here. It don't happen that way. If you can figure out how to do that, you let me know. You can write another one of those millions of books that are out there that have all the answers that people don't have enough focus to read and to apply to their lives. And by the way, don't get me started about kids and their video games or adults on Facebook and all other kinds of social media. We don't have any trouble focusing. We just have trouble focusing on what really matters. Amen? And so Paul says we need to focus on godliness. You know, in any sport, they teach you that one of the most important things that you have to do is be focused. In baseball, keep your eye on the ball. And that's fine until the ball hits you in the eye, and then it hurts. Well, you said keep your eye on the ball. Well, not literally. The idea is you got to be focused. And it doesn't matter what sport that you are relating to. Your coach, your teacher is going to tell you in the training and the preparation and before you ever get on the field to play the game, you have to learn to be focused. One of the most funniest things in the world is when you have kids that are 4 or 5 and maybe 6 and they're playing t-ball or soccer. And they're out there and you got a coach running around. They do more running than the kids because they're trying to get the kids to focus. And the kids are, look, flower, butterfly, you know. And they're so funny and it's cute as all get out unless you're the coach. And then you're pulling your hair out and you're like, could you just focus? And you can forget it. They're not going to do it when they're that age. More than just for a few seconds. Amen. And that's the way I feel like so many of us as believers are in our spiritual lives. We're like that 4-year-old or 5-year-old kid out there on the field. And we're so distracted by all the pretty little things going on around us. And you know, hey church, yeah, we're in church. Oh, there's social media. And hey, my friends, and nobody, you know, and we're all over the place. And it's because we haven't matured yet to where we have made God the priority He needs to be in our life. And it's not a matter of whether God is important enough, because obviously He is. He's the creator of all, and we can't live or breathe or exist without Him. We cannot even be here without Him, but we just don't put Him in the right place of importance in our individual lives. We don't recognize that often enough. So it's important to focus, and it's important to focus on the right things. So let me give you a couple of real quick negatives here. Don't focus on what you can't control. You know, if you're playing sports, you're preparing, they're going to teach you there's some things about the game and in life that you just can't control. And if you, for example, if you're a pitcher and you know and you just threw a strike and the umpire called it a ball, you can't control that. But if you're not careful, it'll get so bad in your head that you won't be able to throw another strike and they'll have to pull you and put somebody else in. You can't control what that umpire calls. You can't control what that batter does. All you can control is the things that you do control. And in our spiritual lives, that's what we have got to do as well. We got to focus on the things that we can control. And there are a whole lot of things going on in this world that we can't control. And we're so scattered with our concentration. We're trying to fill in and be involved and touch base with so many different things. And we are overextending ourselves because we're not focused on what we can control.
Yeah.
And I would also add to that, don't focus on what you've done in the past. It doesn't matter how winning your team is. what you did last year has really zero to do with what's going to happen this year. Now, I can brag for just a moment. It doesn't happen very often, but my Atlanta Braves won the national title last year, okay? But they ain't doing so hot to start this year off. And you know, it often happens that way. And they might not even be in the playoffs this year. And that's perfectly fine. That's okay, because you know what? They're not guaranteed a ride in this year because they won it last year. And that's the same about any other team, about any other sport, and any other area. And you know, it's funny how so many Christians, that all they want to do is talk about what they used to do for God. I used to teach Sunday school class. I used to lead the music. I used to win people to the Lord. I used to do this. I used to do that. And I used to read my Bible. And I used to witness. And I used to, and they got a whole long list. And they live in the glory days. And they'll talk about where the church used to be and what this church used to do and what God used to be doing. And all we do is focus on the past, and we're missing the present because we're living in the past. And you cannot be spiritually fit in your life on an individual basis, nor can a church be spiritually fit if all we do is focus on what we used to do. Thank God for what He did in the past and what He's done in your life and what you did for Him. And that's a part of why you're still here and we're still here. Praise God for that past, but you can't live in it. And what you accomplished in the past and what God did through you in the past doesn't promise or guarantee you anything for tomorrow, let alone for today. And we have got to learn to focus on what God wants to do right here and now, not what He used to do. And it gets me so riled sometimes when I hear all the so much conversation and concentration on all of the things that God used to do, and those same people aren't doing a single thing for the Lord right now. And it's not that I'm ungrateful for what they've done. I just want to say, hello, could you just listen to yourself for a moment? Do you not get it that you're here for a reason? It doesn't matter how young you are, how old you are. It doesn't matter what accomplishments you have in the past. You still have a purpose if you're here. God has a plan for you. If He didn't, you would already be gone. Realize that plan and that purpose and serve God right here and right now. You cannot focus on what used to be and what was once before. Don't focus on heaven. Now that seems a little bit crazy, doesn't it? Because that's your goal. We have songs that even tell us, you know, we're just pilgrims. We're passing through. This world is not my home. Amen?
Yeah.
And that is so true. And we have to keep heaven in a sense in the perspective, and that needs to be our goal. But you know what? If all we do is focus on heaven, we're going to miss what God has for us right here and now.
Right.
There's a phrase that they've used for a long time that says that we can't be so heavenly minded that we're no earthly good. And I believe that that is true for so many. They so desire heaven that they're missing out on what God wants for them right here and now. And I want you to understand that God not only has you here to serve Him here and now, but God also wants to meet with you and make your life so fulfilled in the relationship with Him right here and now. Now, I know it's going to be so much better when we get to heaven, but don't miss out on what God has for you here now because you're so longing for what you got coming one day.
Yeah.
It's going to be good, it's going to be great, and we're going to get there. Let's be faithful and let's be mindful about heaven, but let's not be so focused on heaven that we miss out on the opportunities and the privileges and the blessings that God has for right here, right now, for today.
Yeah.
I believe God is a God of not only the future and not only a God of the past, but He is a God of the present. He wants to be with us right here and today. He wants today to be meaningful. He wants us to have a purpose-filled life right now. Not just, oh, I can't wait to get to heaven because there ain't nothing good here. You know? Well, let's face it, there's a lot of problems in this world. There's a lot of struggles and issues in this world. But listen, you're missing out on the blessings and the presence and the peace of God that passes all the abundance of God right here and now if all you do is long for that day. So, that's the don'ts that I told you I had a few negatives. Now the do. Do under this, and we're still on letter A, yes. Lydia, I haven't abandoned you. Thank you for staying with me. She's patient. I didn't give you all those sub-points, but do focus on living every breath, every day, every moment in this present life for for the Lord. Do focus on living every breath, every day, every moment for the Lord. You know, I don't know what your day yesterday was. Like, I don't know what you did or didn't do, but here's what I know. Yesterday's done and gone. And no matter how much we concentrate on it and think about it and wish we could have, would have, should have, we can't bring back 1 second from yesterday. It's a memory. It's in the past. And we can't change or undo or redo anything about yesterday. Yesterday is gone. All we have is this very moment right here. And we're not promised tomorrow. We might be here tomorrow. We might not. The Lord might split the eastern skies. I'm okay with that too. But we don't know what tomorrow brings. But what we do know is we have this moment right here. And what a shame it is that so many people miss out on this moment because they're always looking backwards or they're always looking forward and they miss the presence.
Yeah.
What God has for us right here and right now. Jesus said when he was teaching the disciples in Matthew chapter 6 verse 11, that very famous prayer, the Lord's Prayer, or the model prayer I like to call it. He said, "Give us each day our daily bread." You notice that? Jesus didn't say, "Give me today what I need for tomorrow." Lord, I don't know what I'm going to have next month, but I want you to go ahead and give it to me. No. You see, the idea was the dependence and the faith and the trust in the Lord for today. For today is all I have. Yesterday's gone. You obviously got me through yesterday. I'm here today, so I have today. Give me what I need today. And it's an awareness of this present moment. And you and I cannot be spiritually fit until and unless we realize that and we begin to capture the moment that God has given us. And you've heard me say this so many times. I've seen and heard so many parents, you know, they get their bundle of joy and they're so proud and so thankful and they love them and they're so thankful for them. And I understand that. I've got three. And when they're so small and they're like, "Oh, I wish they would stay this small forever." No, please don't. Besides, you're going to get tired of that crying baby and changing those diapers. Believe me. And it still feels like you do that for 18 or 19 years. Anyway. But no, you don't want them to stay that small forever. And thank God they don't stay 15 forever either. Amen? But you have every moment. Once. That day and that moment, you have it one time. And many times we miss those moments because we are so busy with our stuff, we miss our moments with our children. And that's the same way we are with our relationship with God. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these things will be provided for you." You see, Jesus' focus and purpose was that this is the day that God has given me. I need to make the most of this day. And the way that I make the most of this day is by seeking the kingdom of God first. And you know, for a lot of people, that means, well, you know, okay, it's time to turn the TV off. I'm getting sleepy, can't hold my eyes open. Oh, you know what? I hadn't read the Bible, I haven't prayed today. Okay, let me open the Bible somewhere and just read a verse and then say a quick prayer and then go to bed. And I'm thankful that at least you are mindful of God and you do make at least that effort, but that's not seeking first the kingdom of God. That's seeking all of the other things that you have on your plate and in your day first. And then when you get around to it, if you get around to it, then you make time for God. And you will, let me tell you, you will miss out. Hear me, please. You will miss out on so much of what God intends for you if that's your intention, if that's your effort, and that's the approach that you have with your relationship with God. You'll be so spiritually unfit. You're going to be so spiritually out of shape. And you're going to wonder, why is my spiritual life so unsatisfying? Why is it that I don't feel that this is meaningful and purposeful and brings joy to my life, if that is your approach? Because you're missing out on what God has for you. And the only way that you and I can really get to that place where God wants us to be and where we long to be eternally and we need to be is when we are focused on godliness and we seek Him first.
Yeah.
First. Not even second after you fix your husband's coffee and breakfast or none of that stuff. Or, you know, it's first. Seek Him first. I like what Brother Jimmy Kilgore says. And his little one of his famous little catches and phrases is no Bible, no breakfast. And what he says is if I find myself in the day and I haven't made time for the Lord and read the Bible, I'm not going to treat myself to breakfast. Now that's just an easy, good way to make sure that you put God first in your life. Letter B. Do work on godliness. You say, wait a minute, you just got to talking about focusing on godliness. Yeah, remember, as a runner, you got to focus on something, right? And as an athlete, you got to focus on something. So we want you to stay focused on the right thing. But you also need to realize you got to work at it. To stay focused on it, you got to work at it. And to work at it, you got to stay focused on it. They go hand in hand. But it's so important to understand both aspects of this. That it's not a gimme, it's not a write-in, it's not automatic. Just because, you know, you prayed that prayer, you knelt at the altar, and you profess Jesus as your Lord, you carry your Bible, and you go to church once a week. That's not an automatic that you are going to be spiritually fit. Thank God you may not be headed straight for hell, but that doesn't mean you're spiritually fit either, amen? We may not be where we need to be. And some say, well, as long as I get in heaven by the skin of my teeth, and I hate that phrase. And I know ultimately our greatest goal is to get to heaven, but I don't know about you, but I know that as a believer right here and right now, God wants me to make the most and enjoy this life and enjoy His presence and His power now, not just wait for that day.
Amen.
And I don't want to just, quote, get there by the skin of my teeth. I want to get there and I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant.
Yeah.
And we cannot get there if we're not working on godliness. You say, wait a minute, now I'm concerned. Because now you're throwing a catchphrase in there. You're talking about a works salvation. Nope, not at all. And I'm not giving you anything biblical, unbiblical. I'm not giving you anything that is man-made. I'm giving you something that's totally biblical in this idea about working on your godliness. Now, remember, your salvation comes only through Jesus Christ. We are saved by faith through, we're saved by grace through faith. That is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You cannot earn your salvation, and you can't earn your way to heaven. You can't do enough good things to get there. But once you are saved, to be and to stay spiritually fit, you got to work at it. You remember last week I told you, you know, if I were to train for, if I wanted to run in a 5K, I'd have to do some training. And I'm not there. I'm far, far from it. But even if I did train and I did get ready, and so I ran in that 5K and I was so satisfied. And I just began to coast the rest of the way. What's going to happen before long? All that training, all that effort, all that exercise is going to just kind of go away. And it won't be long and I'm going to be just as bad a shape as I was before or worse.
Yeah.
Right? You can't stay where you are forever if you don't work at it. You don't stay after it. This past week, this past Friday, Lizzie's volleyball team had a practice and they were invited to invite a friend or a family member. So I got to be one of her friends and got to play volleyball with the volleyball team. And I hadn't played volleyball in a while. And I'm going to tell you, I had a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. I like volleyball. Always have loved volleyball. But can I tell you, my legs are sore today. Getting up out of that chair right there, right on the sides of these legs when I try to push myself up from all the jumping I did at the volleyball net, blocking shots and trying to spike on those poor little girls. Oh, my legs are talking to me today. You know why? Because I haven't been doing that. I hadn't been training for that. I wasn't prepared for that. And you know what? If I want to stay where I'm at right now, I'm going to have to work at it. That's not only true in our physical life, and we could go on and on with that explanation and paint a clearer picture, but the reality is that's also true in our spiritual life.
Amen.
What I want you to understand is godliness is not letting go and letting God, which is some people's mentality. You know, I just come to God and I just let go and He's got it all and I just give it all to Him and that's all there is to it. There is no such thing as you and me drifting into godliness. If we are going to reach a point of godliness and maintain that level of godliness in our life, it's going to be because we work at it. It's because of discipline in our life. You're going to have discipline. Now, we don't like that word. It's not a comfortable word. It's not a convenient word. It means, again, some intentionality. It means we're going to have to put forth some effort. It means we're going to have to make some sacrifices. And to be physically fit, that's the case. You have to have discipline. And that is so true spiritually as well. Think about where your life would be if you had absolutely zero discipline in any area of your life, physically or spiritually. And I'm afraid that for many believers, they haven't given much thought or intentionality or effort into the area of discipline in their spiritual journeys. I got to tell you, the real first example that made any impression and impact on my life about spiritual discipline was, I'm fortunate enough, it happened when I was in Bible college. And I'm still so thankful for him, good friend of mine, Daniel Deans. And he grew up as a missionary child. His family, he was a missionary to Brazil. And when he came to, at that time, Hillsdale Free Will Baptist College, it's now Randall University. And when we were students there together, and I was there because I wanted to be there, and I was there because I felt like God called me to be there, and I was trying to follow God's leadership. I had no idea where that was going to go. I'm serious, zero idea, nothing. I was green as can be. But I knew God wanted me there, and I needed to be there. But I was so thankful to make the friendship with Daniel Deans, because he was a young man that truly loved God. And he was committed to God. And he would get up every morning early, and he would have his prayer time, and he would read his Bible, and he was devoted to God. And it was seen in everything he did and said. Now, there were a whole lot of other students around me that they didn't seem to care at all about their spiritual lives. And they didn't seem to, even though it was a Bible college, there were a lot of students that didn't care much about what the Bible said or what application it might have to their lives at that time. And you could see the difference, especially as a student. You could see the inconsistency and the hypocrisy in many of them's life, but Daniel was the exception. And Daniel modeled discipline for me. Not just someone who said, "I love God," but then had an undisciplined life. But someone who loved God, it oozed out of every breath that he spoke, every word he spoke, every breath that he breathed, and every action in his life, he lived a disciplined life. And that was a great example for me. And you know, the reality is, I'm afraid that there are a lot of believers that don't have that model, don't have that example, and they don't know what it's like to have any spiritual discipline in their life. Maybe they haven't practiced a lot of physical discipline, and so therefore they haven't practiced a lot of spiritual discipline. And they think, as long as I'm saved and I go to church, then that's all that matters. Amen? Hey, I know God. I pray to Him. That's all. That's good. But you don't understand. You're missing out on what God desires for you if that's all there is to your spiritual life. That's not reaching and attaining a higher level of godliness that I believe God wants you to get. You're just, as the phrase is, saved and satisfied. And that's a sad place to be. A very sad place to be. In Philippians chapter 2, by the way, Samson was a good example of someone who had an undisciplined life in the Bible, wasn't he? He was a person with so much ability and so much talent and so much promise, but it was wasted away because he lived a totally undisciplined life. But in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13, we read, "Therefore, my dear friends, just as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but even more in my absence," listen to this, "work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is working in you both to will and to work according to His good purpose." You see, even on the close of that statement, Paul says, God is the one that's going to enable you to do what you need to do. God is the one that's going to enable you to be spiritually fit. But he says, you have a responsibility in your spiritual life. You have a responsibility whether you're going to be spiritually fit or not. He says, you have to work it out. It doesn't mean work for your salvation, but now that you are saved, if you want to maintain a certain spiritual level and grow in your godliness, you've got to work at it. That's what he said. Like you did in my presence, and then even more in my absence. Well, that's some pretty clear instruction about the responsibility that we have to not just get saved and go to church and bring my Bible and wear my t-shirt, but what do I need to do to grow in godliness? And I thought about this, you know, about training. Why do people train when they are working out in the gym? They have some certain goal. They want to get a certain size. They want to have a certain fitness. They have a certain goal in mind. They want to gain certain measures as far as working towards being able to run so long or lift so much weight or build so much muscle, etc. There's all sorts of goals that they have. They're working to gain something. And in the process, they're working to lose something, right? They want to lose some fat and they want to lose some unhealthy habits and that sort of thing. That's true in the physical life, but it's true in the spiritual life as well. And I thought about this. We train in the spiritual life not to gain. We train not to gain, but because we have already gained. You understand that? We're not training to get our way to heaven. We've already got the way to heaven if we're saved through Jesus Christ and Him alone. But because we are saved and because of the redemptive work of Jesus, therefore I'm so grateful and thankful for the work that He's done in my heart and the privilege that He provides for me to know Him, not just then but now, and to walk in His power and His presence. I train because I want more of that. I want more of Him. I'm not satisfied just because I've got my ticket in my back pocket. I want to live and relish in what He's provided for me. So I train not to gain, but because I've already gained. You see, you might even say that sometimes we train so as not to lose. So as not to lose. In other words, we desire to honor God and to know Him more. And the more we know Him, the more we desire to serve Him and to honor Him and to love Him. The more we love Him, you see that cycle, the way that it goes. And the thing is, we realize that sin and the world around us and our natural, fleshly, humanistic ways are the contrary, the opposite of who God is and what God wants for us. And if we're not careful, we will tend, instead of getting closer to God, we'll tend to be lazy and drift a little farther away from Him. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to go back to where I came from, where God brought me out of. I don't have any desire to even get anywhere near that. And so in order to ensure that I don't head in that direction, I got to keep going in the right direction. I can't just stay right where I'm at. I got to keep training so as I don't lose any ground.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
And I don't want the things of this world to so captivate me and distract me and hinder me that I get so caught up in where I'm at that I miss out on where God wants to take me. So, a person who is truly fit doesn't only resist going back to before and to being unfit and unhealthy. He wants to stay fit and do what is necessary to protect his present position with the Lord and his relationship with God. Now, I want to share a verse with you, and then I have several quotes. And I told you I really wanted to get to these quotes. It's so good. But let me give you this verse in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. Paul, writing to Timothy, in our same book, different chapter, Paul said, "Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and teaching." You see what he's saying? It's this idea of discipline, of focus, and being ready, being spiritually fit. You don't get there by, pardon the phrase, by sitting on your spiritual laurels, so to speak. You know, just kick back and taking it easy. That's not how you get there. If you're going to be ready at all times, at any moment, to serve God and to share the gospel with others, it's going to be because you're spiritually fit. You're focused. Now, Jerry Bridges, in The Practice of Godliness, emphasizes our personal responsibility with this. Let me read this quote. And each of these quotes are a few lines, so please be patient. But they're so appropriate. He said, "Timothy was personally responsible for his progress in godliness. He was not to trust the Lord for that progress and then relax. Though he certainly understood that any progress he made was only through divine enablement. He would have understood that he was to work out this particular aspect of his salvation in confidence that God was at work in him. But he would get Paul's message that he must work at this matter of godliness. He must pursue it. We Christians may be very disciplined and industrious in our business, our studies, our home, or even our ministry. But we tend to be lazy when it comes to exercise in our own spiritual lives. Can I get an amen on that one?
Amen.
It's uncomfortable to admit it, right? He said, we would much rather pray, Lord, make me godly. Hear the words. Lord, make me godly, and expect Him to pour some godliness into our souls in some mysterious way. He says, God does in fact work in mysterious ways to make us godly, but He does not do this apart from the fulfillment of our own personal responsibility.
Yeah.
Wow. That's an eye-opener. That's so profound and so simple, yet what a revelation about our responsibility towards godliness. Well, I'm not done. And you thought, well, I figured you weren't. R. Kent Hughes, in The Disciplines of a Godly Man, says this: the rich etymology of discipline suggests a conscious divestment of all encumbrances, and then a determined investment of all of one's energies, just as ancient athletes discarded everything and competed gumnose, or the word for naked. So must the disciplined Christian man divest himself of every association, habit, and tendency which impedes godliness. Can I just break for a moment and paraphrase what he's saying is that in the old days when they would compete, they would remove any and everything that would get in the way of them performing at the best of their ability. And he's saying in the spiritual life, that's what we've got to do, is examine our lives and say, is there anything in my life that would hinder me from performing at my peakest level in godliness for the Lord? If there's anything, any hindrance, I need to remove it. That's what he's saying. Then, with this lean spiritual nakedness accomplished, he must invest all his energy and sweat in the pursuit of godliness. The live, sculpted figure of the classic Greek runner gives the idea. Stripped naked, he has put his perspiration into thousands of miles for the purpose of running well. Even so, the successful Christian life is always, without exception, a stripped down, disciplined, sweaty affair. That doesn't sound very appealing, does it? I mean, we'd rather just pull up the table and eat a big old piece of chocolate pie, amen? That's not the discipline in the spiritual life that we're talking about, is it? Donald Whitney wrote, as we engage in the spiritual disciplines of the Christian life, the Holy Spirit molds us more into the character of the Master. Oh, I love that line. Let me give you that one more time, and I'm not through with this quote, but he said, as we engage in the spiritual disciplines of the Christian life, that means working out our salvation, training, the Holy Spirit molds us into the character of the Master. You see, He does the work. We just got to put forth the sweat labor, amen? The sweat equity. Probably, he says, the most common reason for the lack of spiritual growth among Christians is inconsistency with the spiritual disciplines. How many of you know, by the way, you want to get in shape, so one day out of every 3 months you do push-ups, and then one day out of the next 3 months you might do 10 set-ups, and then you might walk an extra few feet. How many know that ain't going to get you very far on physical fitness, right? Inconsistency. He says, we don't grow in grace if we fail to use the God-given means for growing in grace. It's a simple fact. Those who grow the most and the fastest are those who place themselves in the channels of grace, such as the intake of God's Word, prayer, worship, service, evangelism, silence, solitude, journaling, learning, fasting, and so on. Man, that's good. In other words, again, you don't just stumble into godliness. Well, why are we so interested in godliness? Well, first of all, it's what Paul instructed us to do and be. And secondly, we realize we're in a spiritual battle. We don't want to lose. We don't want the enemy to conquer us. We don't want to be defeated. And next, we don't want to miss out on what God has for us. And we're grateful for what He's already done. A.W. Tozer said, "It will require a determined heart and more than a little courage to wrench ourselves loose from the grip of our times and return to biblical ways. But it can be done. Every now and then," he says, "in the past, Christians have had to do it. History has recorded several large-scale returns led by such men as St. Francis, Martin Luther, and George Fox. Unfortunately," he says, "there seems to be no Luther or Fox on the horizon at present. Whether or not another such return may be expected before the coming of Christ is a question upon which Christians are not fully agreed, but that is not of too great importance to us now. What God in His sovereignty may yet do on a worldwide scale, I do not claim to know. But what He will do for the plain man or woman who seeks His face, I believe I do know and can tell others. Let any man turn to God in earnest. Let him begin to exercise himself in godliness. Let him seek to develop his powers of spiritual receptivity by trust and obedience and humility, and the results will exceed anything he may have hoped for in his leaner and weaker days." Man, that's strong. You see what he's saying is God has so much more for you, you can't even imagine. Don't sell yourself short of what God wants to give you and do in you.
Amen.
I've got two more. Y'all bear with me. I'm almost done. R.C. Sproul in Pleasing God says, he warns about the tragic disassociation of sound doctrine and godly living, explaining that believers must reject a false dichotomy between doctrine and life. We can have sound doctrine without a sanctified life. But it is extremely difficult to progress in sanctification without sound doctrine. Sound doctrine is not a sufficient condition to produce a sound life. It does not yield sanctification automatically. Sound doctrine is a necessary condition for sanctification. It is a vital prerequisite. It is like oxygen and fire. The mere presence of oxygen does not guarantee a fire, but you can't have fire without it. Amen?
Yeah.
And that's good. And then last, John Piper wrote, "Christ came into the world to open a new gymnasium for godliness." I told you we were going to the gym. And he said in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, I believe that's one of our verses, "Bodily exercise is of some value, but working out in the gymnasium of godliness holds promise for the present life and the life to come." Good paraphrase. And he continues, "If it feels good to run 10 miles and lose 5 pounds, it feels 100 times as good to conquer Satan by the power of Christ and break free from some unloving bent in our personality."
Yes.
Ooh. Man, that's solid. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, Paul says, "But by the grace of God, by the grace of God, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary," listen to his words, he says, "on the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was within me." You see what Paul said? Because he was so thankful for God's grace, there wasn't anybody going to outwork him in the area of godliness. But he still gave all the credit to God's grace. But he recognized, because of God's grace, he owed a great debt. spiritual effort and attention and intentionality.
Amen.
And he was not going to be undone. And shame on us as believers in the time of this world in which we live for thinking that we can just coast into heaven. Godly people are disciplined people. It's always been that way, and it's always going to stay that way. Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for the time you've given us in your word today. Thank you for the truth that penetrates deep into our lives. Lord, I know that probably all of us could say that there are times in our life that we wish we had done things differently, had a better focus, better perspective on what really matters, and put priorities in order. Probably all of us can look back over our past and see moments of glory where you showed up in our lives and you've done great things and we have served you and watched you accomplish great things even through our lives. And for all of those things, God, I'm thankful. But I realize that you're not through with us yet. You still have us here for a purpose. And God, we owe such a great debt to you because of your great love and mercy and grace, even as Paul said. What an obligation that creates for us, Lord, to serve you with great focus and faithfulness, intentionality in our lives because of how much you've given us, what you've done for us, how grateful we are to be to you. Not in one moment with any intent for us to gain righteousness or holiness or work our way into heaven, but because of what we've already gained. God, I pray that you would speak through these simple words today. And I pray, Lord, that you would, through the Holy Spirit, bring about conviction in our lives. Convict us, Lord, for our laziness. Convict us over our apathy and our complacency. And help us, Lord, to buy into your vision of our spiritual lives and the fitness that you would have for us. And help us, oh God, to not settle for anything less. And may your Spirit move mightily in these closing moments of our service, we pray in Jesus' name. Would you stand, please, with your heads bowed, as Marcus comes to lead us in a song of invitation. If the Spirit of God is dealing with you about your spiritual journey, your life today, would you just respond, whether it's kneeling right there, praying where you stand, or coming to the altar and praying, would you respond in obedience to him?
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad hearted and free. This a blessing for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee.
Assure you of this one truth. Sometimes the hardest thing to do about getting physically fit is making that decision to make the sacrifice and take that first step, get in the gym, give up certain things, start doing what is healthy and right. That's not only true in the physical, but that's also true in the spiritual. It's one thing to realize where we are, what we need to do, what we should have been doing. It's another to take the necessary steps to get there. And sometimes the hardest thing is that first step, just that first movement towards God. But I assure you, you take the first step, God will meet you there. And God will bless you, and God will help you, and He will equip you, and He will enable you, and He will guide you, and He will take you to where you need to be.
Jonathan, would you dismiss us in prayer?